Alrighty, welcome back everybody. It's Sports Chat.
503.
Oh man, we beat Stanford. How good does that feel?
That was sweet, man. I loved it. Yeah. That was great.
Yeah.
Like that's Oregon offense. That's Oregon football. Yeah,
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. I just loved, I kept saying, basically at the top of my lungs, screaming at the television, now talk it up, people, how good is Stanford? How good is Stanford? Because
yeah.
Oregon is that much better.
Yeah, exactly.
You
yeah.
know what I mean?
Yep.
So I love the fact that everybody thought Luck was the second coming. I love the fact that everybody thought the power. Oh, what was Oregon going to do with the power defense?
Yeah, they're just going to line up and run all over
the same
Oregon.
Thing I said last week Oregon was going to do. Score by two or three touchdowns. So it was going to look like last year.
Yeah.
And it did.
Yeah,
oh, it was nice.
Yeah, and it was from, you know, there was a couple of three and outs to start the quarter for each team and you know, feeling out process. And as
right.
soon as Oregon got on the board, they never looked back, man.
No.
Like, it was, yeah, it was great, man.
All right, so today, one, we're drinking the California Cabernet in honor of the Cardinal.
There you go.
And then, yeah. And then, so we'll get through our normal little shtick here. We're going to do our Oregon recap.
Sports Chat 503.
We're gonna do our recap, and then we're gonna do our look ahead for SC for next week.
Yeah.
And then we look at the rest of the Pac-12, the rest of the NFL.
Nation.
And then we got to talk about this PSU thing and Paterno a little bit. That,
yeah.
That has to happen at some point during
yeah.
the thing. And then I got a interesting one. What to do and not to do in a riot / the Paterno thing, or we have in Portland this Occupy thing that's getting
yeah.
what are kind of some of the rules, the do's and don'ts to what you should do
that's
as
good.
An occupier protester and also as the police force. What
yeah.
are some of the things that are do's and
yeah,
don'ts?
Yeah, that's a good point. That's,
yeah.
that's a good one.
Yeah, we'll spend some 10 minutes at the end of the deal. I know
yeah.
some people like the little rules kind of segment we have. If you dig on that, cool.
Yeah.
If you don't, no problem.
Watch
it's an hour
anyways.
Long.
Yeah,
yeah. It's an hour long video. You can pick and choose what you like to do. Okay, one thing really quickly that Bo and I were talking about. In the past, we used to have a time restriction. And that time restriction made us only do videos for like 10 minutes at first, or then 15 minutes or whatever when YouTube expanded it. And we used to come together, this is a Sunday night, we usually do a Sunday night or a Monday night, and we'd come together with like three or four topics of the week, sports topics to talk about. And we used to have to do separate videos.
Yeah.
Now we do it all in one. So if you have a comment, if you want to do smaller videos or do longer videos, I'm sorry, we don't really cater to anybody, we're going to do exactly what we want to do. But it would be interesting to know if you guys dig a smaller video instead of the longer video. We're still got to talk for an hour, people. It's still going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
Four topics, 15 minutes each, and there we go.
Yeah.
So, first things first, Stanford, the Cardinal. First of all, how can your mascot be a color? Because Stanford, they're not the bird, the Cardinal.
Yeah.
No, they're the color.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
They're Stanford
oh, wow,
Cardinal,
man.
As in the color red. Their mascot is a tree.
Yeah, I guess I never...
Because the symbol is a tree.
I guess
the symbol for University of Oregon is a mountain.
Oh,
are we
okay. going
to have a mountain as our mascot right, running around?
Yeah, getting suspended for being drunk.
So they have a tree as their mascot. Their mascot is actually a color, the Stanford Cardinal. How smart are these people?
Yeah.
That they have to try to outsmart the room by having their mascot be a color.
Yeah, and have the color named the same as a bird. Cardinal red.
They have nothing to do with the birds. There is no bird.
Yeah.
There's no bird.
There is no bird.
It's not the St. Louis Cardinals.
Yeah, right.
It's not the Lincoln Cardinals.
Yeah.
Portland.
Portland, no.
It's the color.
Yeah.
Okay. Second thing, really quickly.
That's actually good information. I'm glad you told.
Yeah. Since I'm on a little bit of a rant.
Yeah.
What the hell's the deal with their marching band? I hate their marching band. Okay.
Really?
For one, they got banned from the state of Oregon in the 80s because they did, yes. Because they did some tribute to the spotted owl. And they're basically just, they're super intelligent band nerds. So they're very good at band. But they don't take it seriously at all. It's like, so it's called something like the something Junior Leland Junior Varsity Marching Band or something.
Really?
It's this bizarro title.
Wow.
Last year on South Beach, they had this whole thing. You should go look up the YouTube video. They're all doing this thing on South Beach because they went down there for the bowl when they played. Who they played? Virginia Tech or somebody last year.
Yeah.
And, yeah. Anyway, they have no uniform. People are wearing coconut bras, shorts, jeans. Yeah. Yes, there is no standard uniform.
Wow.
They just kind of have a, just a bizarro thing. The Oregon band was louder at that game, and the Oregon fans were louder at that game.
Yeah.
If you rewatch it or watch the highlights, you hear Oregon cheering when we score.
Yeah.
You hear Oregon loud when Stanford's on defense, and you hear our band. You hear our...
That's awesome.
We just took a home game down to the Bay.
That is sweet.
Love it.
Yeah, your unks went to the game, too.
Yeah, my unks represented it, dude. My unks, former season ticket holder. He went to Oregon as well. Basically went there for, like, summer school one year.
Hey,
didn't really take, but, you know.
Yeah,
you know. My unks drove down there. I had no idea. He calls me a couple times that day, and I thought it was a little weird that he called me a couple times. So I call him back. I wasn't even at home. I call him back. I get the message. I don't even get the message. I just get the, like, kind of sound. I'm like, hello? He's like, hey, is it a little loud? I was like, yeah. I said, where are you? He's like, I'm at the game. And my unks is huge. Big dude, quick, super tall, broad, just, I mean, looks like, you know, Grizzly Adams. He doesn't like to sit in the seats, so he kind of goes and tries to stand.
Oh,
yeah. He was standing
cool,
in his place.
Man.
Yeah, first quarter, first half. Finds these four, handicapped seats. Nobody's sitting in them. Three people come down and sit in them for, like, a quarter or whatever, leave. He's like, screw it, I'm sitting right here. So he had room. He stretched out. He's
buddy.
Sitting in the game the whole second half. Lounging.
That's a move.
Drove from
right
Portland
there.
To Palo Alto to go to the Stanford game.
That's sweet, man.
Used to be a season ticket holder. Has not gone to a game at Oregon or Austin maybe. I think last year, but he hadn't gone to any games this year.
Yeah.
He's a ticket guy. He'd go online and buy tickets and then resell them and everything. Yeah. So he had tickets to this Oregon-Stanford game. I was like, you are unbelievable.
Yeah, that's great, man.
Okay, so all that stuff aside, sorry to waste your time with all that. Okay, boom. Stanford, we ran them.
Yeah.
We were louder. We were stronger. We were faster. The Ducks represented it. And national television.
Yeah.
One of the very first times Oregon has ever been on the national television, the entire country. The BCS last year, they show the Rose Bowl, but people have a choice of whether they want to watch the Rose Bowl or another bowl because other bowls happen at the same time.
Yeah.
So basically the national championship was the first game last year where Oregon was in every television set across the country.
Mm-hmm.
ABC had no other game in the time slot. Coast to coast saw that game.
Yeah, that's
pretty
sweet.
Dude.
I love that. Yeah, it was a great game, man. A lot going on there, man. Like, you know, you want to talk about national exposure. You got the Ducks. You got Huff with a 58-yard touchdown pass.
Yeah.
Where he basically, like you were saying, it's like an 8 or 10-yard pass, makes a couple moves, gone.
Yeah, it's not intended to be a big play. It's just a normal play from scrimmage.
Yeah.
And he's just a great athlete and breaks the thing, is gone.
Yeah, you got LaMichael with a 58-yard touchdown run. Comes up, breaks through the line, couple moves, gone.
Gone.
Then you got DeAnthony Thomas.
Just like last year.
41-yard screen pass on fourth down.
Fourth and seven.
And boom, touchdown. I mean, you want to talk about, like, showing off your skills.
And a great, if we talk about that screen for a second.
Yeah.
I mean, Thomas was on almost his back throwing it. The whole defense had sold out. Nobody was in the area.
Yeah.
Had the one lineman out in front. There was nobody.
Yeah.
Wide open.
Yeah, you want to talk about, like, national exposure, man. There you got, like, passes, screen passes, rushing game. I mean, they can hit you in all different ways.
Yeah, and Huff, true sophomore. DeAnthony, true freshman.
Yeah.
So you're talking about two kids who are the youth of the program, but the youth of the program is going to come next year, too. We're just going to get studs. We're going to keep bringing them in,
so
people.
It's not like all Oregon can do is line up and run the ball on you, you know?
Mm-mm.
I mean, we're scoring on screens and on passes.
And then
down.
Lavoisier, 2-and-A in the back of the end zone.
Yeah, that was a great touchdown catch also, the first one of the game. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that was really good for national exposure. Show how versatile they are.
Oh, yeah. And the D.
Yeah,
dude. Talk about the D for a little bit.
Yeah,
you and I both love defense.
Yeah, and they got it going last week against Washington, which we both noticed. They had some sacks and they had some picks last week. Oregon was real good last year with takeaways. Haven't been as good this year. But, against
I think they've been good. They just haven't been capitalized. They haven't actually done it. They've knocked the pass down instead of intercepted it.
Yeah.
They caused the fumble but didn't recover it.
Mm-hmm.
So they're still, in essence, getting the same opportunities. They're just not taking advantage of the opportunities. Yeah. Now they're actually starting to capitalize on them.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Oregon had...
And score off them.
Yeah, and score off them. Yeah, Oregon had 3 sacks. They got 2 picks off of Luck, and they recovered 3 fumbles. What's his name? Lacombo?
Yeah, Boseko. Well, first of all, let's go back to DeWitt Stuckey's interception, because Michael Clay had an interception where he jumped the receiver, the jumped the route or whatever.
Yeah.
What I liked, what I was seeing about Oregon, and I try to watch defense, you know, through a educated eye.
Yeah, through a
monocle,
trained eye. Yeah. Yeah.
So
educated eye.
Yeah, an educated eye. Nothing ignorant about this eye. So when I looked at the defense, I saw that they would have kind of a sandwich on the receiver.
Yep.
They would have the cornerback guarding almost behind, okay? Mm. And then they'd bring the linebacker over. And so if you're on the sideline and you're a receiver, you're going down and you're wide open. The quarterback sees that you're wide open. There's no defender in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
So the boom, throws the ball, and all of a sudden, bam, linebacker right in front for the interception.
Yeah.
So it's not like a cornerback interception where it's either a bad throw or the cornerback just outworks the wide receiver.
Yeah, it jumps the route or something.
It's a perfect route. It's perfectly thrown. All of a sudden, hey, where'd that linebacker come from?
Yeah.
And so Michael Clay got one of those, and then DeWitt Stuckey is, man, that guy is a stud. And he picked that thing. It was so clean.
Yeah.
And I was just real impressed. I was also really impressed with, I heard the stat when I was on there that they had only punted 9 times all year.
Stanford? Oh, wow.
They punted in the first 2 possessions against Oregon.
Wow.
So, I mean, those are the kind of things where, you know, you know that not only is your offense showing up, but your defense is. And I've said this for years. Oregon has always been a prolific offense. If they have a good defense, it is scary.
Yeah.
You better watch the hell out.
Yeah, and I think Stanford had another crazy stat kind of like that where they, I think they had only given up something like 6 sacks all season or 4 sacks. All season, I think it is.
Sure.
And Oregon got 3 of them.
Right.
So, yeah, that was really impressive.
They were just swarming.
Yeah, and that's the crazy thing, too, that kind of bugged me a little bit is the announcers kept talking about how, well, you know, if Luck had some, like, real receivers, all he basically has is like, possession receivers and a couple tight ends.
Yeah, but they didn't stretch the field that much with a WUSU before.
Yeah, and my point is that, well, he had good enough receivers to throw to make him a Heisman winner last year.
Right.
And he had good enough receivers to make him, and people to throw to make him the number one Heisman contender and the number 4 team in the country this year.
Right.
So, I mean, it's like, how come all of a sudden they're playing Oregon now? Oh, he doesn't have anybody to throw the ball to.
Well,
it's like, what are you talking about? They've been successful all year throwing the football.
Exactly.
So don't give me that garbage, man.
Yeah. I personally think that when you have the... when you listen to the announcers, they actually don't... It sounds like they don't really want the Ducks to do well.
Yeah,
they want to give every reason possible for the other team. Now, maybe every fan base has that feeling that the announcers are talking against their team.
Yeah.
But until the Ducks start really running away with it, is only when the announcers just start kind of like almost laughing at how good Oregon is.
Right, exactly.
They don't go from a thing of just giving them respect up front.
Yeah.
It's always about like, oh, they're just so fast. Nobody can hang with this team.
Another touchdown for the lightning fast Ducks.
Yeah, exactly. Whereas, you know, I think they want to love on Luck. They want to love on the more traditional sort of teams because that's what they know.
Yeah.
They don't really know what they're showing on here. And again, I love this website. If you want to go check this thing out, Fish Duck. This guy is perfect because this guy says what everybody else doesn't say. Everybody else, they know this much about the Oregon offense. They really don't understand what they're watching.
Yeah.
So you have to go to people who know the offense, people who know what they're talking about, to actually see what's happening there.
Mm-hmm.
So I love it, man. I think Chip is phenomenal, and I just am so happy with this program right
now. Yeah. You know, I want to say real quick, I was a little surprised with the turf. People were slipping and sliding all over for both teams.
I think everything should be AstroTurf now. The technology is
good enough. The newer, like, fake grass.
The technology is good enough. You can put the thing under it. Oregon redid their field and had the big layer underneath it for, you know, concussions and everything.
Yeah.
Redo them.
Yeah.
Keep it an even playing field. Why do some have this and have a grass field? That field is going to be absolute trash next week.
Yep.
And it's going to be terrible for the whole rest of the playoffs.
Yeah.
Why couldn't we play on a real turf? Why couldn't you actually see the lines?
Yeah, it's crazy, but, you know, the thing that kind of bugs me is that, like, this game, Yeah, players sliding around, and it was supposed to be some kind of new sod that they had put in.
Right.
They did the same last year for the national championship. Yes. Kids were sliding around all over the place on the field. It's like, can't these people get it right?
Right.
In terms of field conditions? I mean, and it's not like there's that much of a change year to year in terms of, like, precipitation or climate.
Or how to do it.
Yeah, or, even technology. So I don't,
Well, they have a week to put them in. That's the biggest thing. I mean, they put them in, they water the hell out of them, and,
Yeah, I noticed in the game, though, a lot of people were talking about the key to getting Oregon, beating Oregon was to get Oregon's offense out of rhythm by penetrating. And the total opposite happened. Is Oregon took control of the game early, and that caused Stanford's 3 yards in the cloud of dust power running game, and then you work your play action off that.
Right.
They couldn't stick to that once they started getting down. So Oregon actually changed the rhythm of Stanford's offense.
Sure.
So it was exact opposite of what people were saying was gonna have to happen in this game. Right. So
well, the other thing I think is hilarious is when they talk about how cruising through the line, penetration through the line is the secret to solving the Ducks' offense.
Yeah.
Sometimes the Ducks use that against them.
Yeah.
So go ahead and penetrate all you want, and now the quarterback is gone.
Yeah.
Now we throw the thing out for a pitch. Now we throw them. So it's not just all about pin your ears back and attack.
Yeah.
You can't do that
because
then Oregon is going to recalibrate that thing and use that against you.
Yeah, use your over-penetration.
You know, the biggest thing I said it after
that. Cutback lane.
Exactly. I said it after that Auburn game. We didn't block fairly. It wasn't that fairly dominated our line.
Yeah.
We would slide down, and we wouldn't even block the guy. Go watch the replays of it.
Yeah.
The fourth and goal play, the freaking third and goal play, nobody's even blocking this guy. This guy is in the National Football League. Nobody's even blocking him. So it's just, it's insane when you start talking about, the small Ducks or, the finesse Ducks are getting overpowered. But they're not.
Yeah.
They are a big team, dude. Wade Kikipelli, Ricky Hamui, those guys in the middle of the D-line are big.
Mm-hmm.
Deion Jordan is not big across the middle, but he's 6'7".
Yeah, he's a big man.
And yeah, exactly. And Terrell Turner's not that tall, but he's thick down low. And the Terrell Turner, dude, that was the play that did it.
Yeah.
That was the knife in the back and just twisting it.
Yeah, that was sweet, man. I like
because
that.
Because then you get the fumble.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not only is it a sack on luck, but it's a fumble. And you got to be opportunistic. That game we went to at Washington, how many third downs did we get a sack?
Yeah.
See, I don't care about a first down sack. Puts them out of range. I care about a third down and two.
Yeah.
It's third and two, and they drop back on it, and you collapse the pocket on them.
Yeah, man.
Dude, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, so
that's
what's
showing up.
Yeah, that was good, man. The Duck defense did well. On the Ducks' offense, Darren Thomas ran it 7 times, which is a little out of the ordinary.
Yeah.
But it's good because it keeps the defense honest. They can't just focus in on LaMichael and play that. If you keep it a few times a game, it makes the defense spread out more. And he was 11 for 17, no interceptions.
Right.
So he did his job just fine.
Beautifully.
Yeah, he had I guess with the screen pass, that's 3 touchdown passes he had. So.
For the first time ever in my life, I'm feeling like a real journalist now with this little sports chat. I actually took notes during this game. I have 10 points that I was making here.
Okay, let's hear them.
Okay, Oregon fans and the band were louder.
Nice.
Oregon's got more speed and more power.
Yeah.
They didn't get outpowered. They overpowered Stanford.
Yeah.
Okay? Also, they had stamina. Stanford was dragging, not Oregon. Good defense in the middle. Linebackers and the linemen up front. Solid in the middle. They held the running game.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to pound the ball in the running game, and they couldn't. They couldn't get anywhere. Mm-hmm. That Stephon Taylor had 20 carries in the first half.
Wow, are you serious?
Dude,
he probably
had more than 20, but he had 20 when I wrote the note.
Holy cow, man.
The linebackers were making great tackles. So not only were they just getting good hit, they were bringing the guys down.
Yeah, I noticed that too. There wasn't.
Kiko had a great wrap up on Taylor.
Yeah.
Kiko Alonso just wrapped him up.
Yeah, there wasn't a lot of,
falling
forward for a couple extra yards kind of thing. Yeah, they were stopping him.
And they were wrapping him up. I don't like that tackle where you just power the shoulder and the guy keeps running.
Yeah.
So they were really wrapping up well. Luck is awesome. The guy can make some amazing throws.
Yeah.
The guy, if he had an NFL team around him, I would be loving to see him.
Yeah, man. You know, there was, you
he's
know,
NFL ready last year.
To Stanford and Deluxe credit, well, I guess to their demise also, there were a number of drops.
There were a couple of them. The guy across the middle, the wide or the tight end, whose money on a third down play bounced just right off of his hands.
Yeah, just so.
That doesn't mean that Stanford's going to win.
Right, but
yes, those playing there are some for sure.
Or like the pick at the end of the game, right, where it went right off the guy's hands,
exactly
off the freshman receiver's hands, and then we got it.
Stanford's good, Oregon's better.
I like that one. What number is that? What number
was that? That one is number seven.
Seven? I like that's my favorite.
Because this is in the first half. So I'm thinking that, you know, Stanford's actually hanging with Oregon here. But you can tell from the very first snap that Oregon was a better team.
Yeah.
Oregon dominated the game from start to finish. There was no question.
Yeah.
Zero. Fourth and seven, the screen pass to D'Anthony.
That was awesome.
And that was my last thing for the half. 22-16 at the half, but they were dominating.
Mm-hmm.
So it looked like, you know, that was like almost the end score of the national championship game.
Yeah.
That's first half. Worst field goal I've ever seen by Stanford. It looked like he kicked it to the other, to the sideline. He was trying to go coffin corner.
Yeah, like some things did not go right for Stanford.
Dude, that was brutal. Now, maybe that was like the footing or something, the field.
The guy missed the first extra point of the game, too.
Bad.
Yeah.
Bad. Like, this one looked like he was literally going coffin corner. It's like, dude, this isn't a punt. Turnovers and good defense, man. Turnovers were the key. They scored off. I think Oregon had something 20 points off turnovers or something like that.
Yeah.
So that's the way it is. Now, can we move on? Are we good with Stanford? Or do you need
anything else? You know, I was just going to say, Oregon was 1-for-9 on third down conversions, which I'd like to see improve.
Yes.
You know, Oregon beat them by 23, which is a good number. I'll take that any day of the week.
Yeah, third down, you got to improve.
But third
on.
Down conversion, yeah, and we do go for it a lot on fourth down. There were
so you think that is that a mental side? Do you think that they're not so concerned with getting it on third down?
I think
because
so.
Because they know they're
going
to go for it?
Yeah, because a lot of teams will try to go for the first down on third down, knowing if they don't get it, they'll punt. Whereas Oregon,
that's an interesting
they'll
concept.
Take a 4 or 5 yard gain to make it fourth and manageable, where other teams are doing that play on for second down.
Yeah, because they go fourth down their territory all the time.
Yeah, so Oregon. like if you're a regular team, if it's second and 10, you'll try to get 4 or 5 yards so it's a third and manageable.
Exactly.
Oregon does that on third down to make it fourth and manageable.
Right.
And the thing that...
That's got to screw with the defense.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
Defense, and you just when you think you're out of there.
Yeah, and the one thing that I really liked about Oregon is when they got to play all the way down to like the 2 yard line, and it was fourth down and goal, and I was there yelling on the TV,
oh, yeah.
Go for it, line up, go.
Yeah.
And they lined up quick, and Stanford was confused, and they didn't know what to do.
Bam.
They hike it, give it to LaMichael, he just walks right in.
Untouched
and it's
almost.
Like, yeah, exactly, and it's like, that's... That's Oregon football, man.
Yep.
That's what they do to
and
you.
And that's just any... That should be any football.
Yeah.
I mean, that,
yeah, that's just discipline.
It's just discipline.
Yeah.
We know what we're going to do.
Yeah.
We're going to do it.
Yeah, and Stanford's over
we're
there
not gonna
going
wait
like...
for you.
Yeah, they're like, holy shit, are we supposed to send in the field goal block team? Or what are we doing?
Exactly.
And then LaMichael's walking in the end zone. So, yeah, I appreciated that. The Yeah, so, yeah. I
also like the fact the ball was bouncing Oregon's way a little bit. LaMichael loses the ball on the punt.
Yeah.
We end up stopping them. They go worst field goal ever. We get the ball back, punt it to them. Then they lose it. We get the ball back and score.
Yeah.
I was like,
yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
One, the LaMichael play never even hurt because they didn't score off of it. Two, we ended up scoring
off of their turnover. Yeah.
So I loved it. Yeah. Okay. Next week, SC. I will be at the game. I will do my normal... Bam, I will do my normal routine. This is going to be the big one because I think SC's good. I think they're as good as Stanford, if not even maybe a little bit better right now than Stanford is right now.
Yeah, it could
be. Big thing is, though, Oregon, we are bringing game day.
We're kind of peaking right now,
We're bringing game day. Yeah. The ESPN game day should have their own truck just parked out here.
Outside Austin.
Because we brought game day for the very first time to Corvallis last year.
No,
we brought
right.
it to Stanford last week because it was the very first time. So it wasn't like, oh, let's go to see Stanford. It was like, let's go see Oregon at Stanford.
Yeah,
bringing
right.
it this week again for the SC week.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So, I mean, you're just, the idea is that, man, Oregon is just running with it. And they're just so freaking sexy. There's so many things out there with college football that are just old and tradition, and you just go because you like to go. I love what I'm seeing from Oklahoma State. They're just putting up awesome numbers. Yeah, they're doing it cool, whatever.
Yeah, they're flinging it, man.
And I love these new uniforms people are putting in. Yeah. It gave a jolt to Wazoo for the new uniforms, gave a jolt to ASU. Yep. So Nike's doing things with Oregon that is setting the tone for how everybody else is wanting to do it after that. Oregon is becoming an example of the newest thing, the most popular, the most...
Yeah.
That's pretty sweet, dude. Yeah. From an old school Oregon fan, that is pretty sweet, man, because we've never really been there.
Yeah, and
we got huge flack for putting the thing up with Joey Harrington, remember?
Yeah, the Heisman candidate.
Oh, we got huge flack for doing that, or changing the uniforms.
Yeah,
or anything.
What do they call it? Square...
Madison Square, across from MSG.
The, what's that in New York there? The, area. Times Square.
Right, Times Square. Yeah. But it was right across from MSG. It was like you walked outside of the Knicks game and saw...
Joey Harrington, yeah.
But we just like to do things unconventional. Why not? Because we don't really have a tremendous amount of history to base ourselves on. We're not Penn State. Yeah. We're not Oklahoma, Texas, Michigan. We don't have a huge history. We're like, oh, look, last Rose Bowl we won was 1917.
Yeah.
We lost the thing in 1958 and we carried our coach off the field.
Yeah, and it's not like we're in some crazy big market too, like in LA or in Miami or...
No, we live in Portland. It's like the 27th largest city in the United States.
Yeah, I mean, it's like with all the cults and things like that we have running around Oregon and we're the trendsetters for
football.
It's
crazy.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome, man. Yeah.
So go Ducks.
Yeah, okay. Come check out the cult, sir.
Exactly. Awesome. Okay, SC. SC scares me. Okay. SC scares me more than any other team purely because they have power and speed.
Okay, now I was going to say, do they scare you because of the implications of the game? Or like if this was the first game of the season.
No, we knew that.
If this was the first game of the season for the Ducks, would you be as scared?
Yes, because it's SC.
Oh, really?
SC is always SC. SC is Pac-10's Michigan.
I thought maybe you were scared more because basically,
the implications are big.
If we win this, we're probably going to end up winning the Pac-12.
I mean, yes, so. that says it all. But also, you could lose this game and still go to the championship game because you beat Stanford.
True, yeah. So,
I mean, the ideology to me is that I just think SC is awesome. They always are awesome. They always will be awesome. You can't stop them unless you put them with a real dipshit coach, which I think they have. For the most part, I don't think Kiffin is that great of a coach.
Yeah.
I think that their program is slowly going down because of this investigation thing that blew them. But my dad was telling me that the sanctions or whatever are starting like this year, next year, not like from the last 3 years. So all this they have scholarship reductions, and they take 10 each year or something like that. And so they haven't even really started yet.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, I think Barkley's good. I think that Woods is awesome. Yep. I think that big tackle is awesome. He's going to be one of the first picks in the draft. Yep. They always have good lineups.
Yeah.
They always got good athletes in the backfield.
Yeah, they just have athletes.
They just have athletes everywhere. So I just think that Oregon is physically matched up against them. We actually patterned our team after trying to beat them. How are we going to beat SC? That's how we designed.
So fast and so deep.
So I think that D'Anthony has an amazing game.
Yeah, just wouldn't that be
absolutely
sweet?
Stick it to him. I still think Oregon wins. I still think Oregon wins maybe by a touchdown or two. Maybe it's a blowout like last year. But I mean, the last 2 years, Oregon has beat them by 20 points.
Yeah.
The Halloween game, the year of the Rose Bowl, and then last year down there in the all-white with the silver shoes.
Nice, yeah.
That was
man.
The one where Mayo had the catch where he's bobbling at the end zone. Yeah. I mean, both those games are like 40-20.
Yeah, that's interesting that you say, I forgot. You said powerful and fast. Mm-hmm. How do you describe them?
Well, they have... So do they
speed
have,
and power.
Do they have just as much power as Stanford?
See, it's a good point because
they're faster than Stanford.
Yeah, they're faster than Stanford. They've got McNeil in the backfield as running back, who's like a scat back. He's real fast. He's a good kid. They also have Tyler, the 230-pound power back.
Right.
And so that's going to give a little bit different look than Stanford gave them in terms of the running game, because Stanford didn't really have that speed back to go along with the big power back Taylor, is that what his name was?
Yeah, Stephon Taylor.
Yeah, so I think this is going to be interesting, because like you said, they're fast, they're deep, even though they have these
Oregon's
sanctions.
Oregon's D is rolling right now. The Washington game and last week against Stanford, they are rolling.
Because I was going to say, USC, they've been playing, I mean, they played Colorado last week and that's nothing, but they beat Washington, beat the pants off them this week.
Yeah, crushed them.
So they're playing pretty good. Two weeks before that is when they took SC down to the wire. Or Stanford, down to the wire. But, you know, the only team in the Pac-12 that's, I think, peaking more right now is Oregon.
Yeah, of course.
And so Oregon is peaking at the right time.
I agree.
And so it's going to be a good game. I think Oregon's going to win. I think it's going to be a little bit different of a game than Stanford because they're going to have that big play ability that Stanford doesn't have.
You're right.
That one shot, boom.
I can see them being up at halftime. I can see SC being up. I mean, I have no idea how it's going to go, but I really think that SC is the second best team in the conference. And everybody wants to make Stanford out to be the second best team. And you know, Stanford did beat them, but SC had that game.
Yeah, it was...
I mean, that should have been probably SC's game.
Yeah, it should have been. And
I don't like Barkley, though. I think he'll be okay. Yeah. I think he's a pretty good quarterback. I have nothing against him on that level. I just don't like him. I don't like his style. He's kind of like my version of Tim Tebow. I don't like him.
Southern California playboy, blondie kind
of. It's not any of that. I just don't like how he's. I think he's kind of a pansy. I just think he's kind of like a little. Okay. I think he's fluffier. I like
Hollywood.
I don't even think.
Not
all
even
that.
Hollywood.
No, though. I think he's just light. You know, I think he's lighting the loafers. I think he's a little bit.
That's Hollywood, right there.
I think that we can give him a nice solid shot right in the middle of his chest, and he'll come back maybe not as tough as he did before. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's the kind of quarterback I don't want. I want a quarterback like Roethlisberger, who's like, bring it on, like Rocky.
Yeah.
You know, he wants to get hit. I think Thomas is like that. I think Thomas likes to get popped around a little bit. He throws that ball at the very last second and just lets that thing fly and then just gets hammered by those defensive linemen.
Yeah, man, you don't mess with Texas, man.
No, I think Barkley's a good quarterback, but I think we can drop him.
Yeah.
And I think we did the luck a little bit, too.
Yeah, I think we rattled him a little bit.
That's
he wasn't used to being on his back.
No, he was not. Or used to having a guy coming right at him as he's throwing it. And I think that we're probably going to do that same thing. Mm-hmm. I think that SC's good. They're just not disciplined. And that's the problem with SC. They always have the best athletes. But in the past, when Oregon's beat them, it's because they did not have good discipline. Oregon was a better game plan. Oregon had better stability in their athletes or whatever it was. But The SC could pretty much roll out the ball and beat most teams.
Yeah, and we talked earlier in the season about how, you know, you can't sleepwalk some of these teams like SC because, you know, if you come out and you have, you know, God forbid you have a few turnovers or injuries, you know, a team like SC could wind up beating you.
Exactly.
So that's why you can't float on a lot of these Pac-12 teams. I mean, like, are we all done with USC for now?
Well, I think one other thing about USC is that they kind of had the same syndrome as Oregon. They barely beat Minnesota the first week of the season.
Wow.
And people looked at that as like, oh, come on, you can't beat Minnesota. And they kind of just brushed them off. And then here they go, and they just keep beating teams. And now they're right in the thick of it, even though they're bowl ineligible.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think that SC is a powerhouse. And I think that off the win of Stanford, I think we're ready to rumble.
Yeah, because I was going to say, you know, you can't let these Pac-12 teams kind of, you can't slip against them. Because, like, the other Pac-12 scores this week, like, Wazoo beating Arizona State.
Right.
Halliday,
that happened.
Yeah, Halliday, the freshman for Washington State, 494 yards passing, 4 touchdowns.
And beat him by 10.
Yeah.
But it was terrible conditions up there.
Yeah.
It was snowing, and, it was
Is that
nasty.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. So, but I mean, you know, some of these teams, man, you give them an inch or give them the feeling that they can actually hang in the game and you can have problems.
Well, I mean, look at LSU. Oregon had one bad half and is out of the national championship.
Yeah.
I mean, one bad half. They lost by 13 points and gave 20 points away from turnovers, lost by 13.
Yep. And
they had one bad half.
And you know what? Even
the first half of football for the whole year with brand new players, everything else, they came out and they had some injuries or had some turnovers, and that was it.
Yeah. And you know what? Even though Oregon lost that game, I still would rather have Oregon play that game against a top team and lose,
of course,
than be a team like Boise State and play a bunch of nobodies and then bitch at the end of the year that they went undefeated.
Well,
and I'm not getting a shot.
Last year, New Mexico, Portland State. I mean,
yeah.
So it's one of those things where it's like, you know, when you had last year, you didn't play basically anybody.
Yeah.
And then you have this year where you play LSU.
Yeah. Well, I played Tennessee last year, didn't
I? Yeah, but Tennessee, you know, you make the schedule years in advance.
Yeah, yeah.
So who knew Tennessee was going to be where they were?
Yeah.
Tennessee was a great time to go out there to go to the SEC or whatever, but Tennessee's not that good of a team.
Yeah.
Which goes back to my theory about the SEC.
Everybody, Big Daddy, not me.
Everybody wants to make the SEC out to be this great team, or this great conference, and it is at the top.
Yeah.
But its bottom sucks.
Yeah.
The bottom of the SEC is just as bad as the bottom of the Big 12, just as bad as the bottom of the Big 10, or just as bad as the bottom of the Pac-12.
Yeah.
I mean, they suck.
Yeah.
So the ideology of having, SEC football, this is SEC. Well, who's Georgia going to beat out here? Who's Georgia going to beat? Southern California would beat the hell out of Georgia right now.
Yeah.
Right now.
Yeah.
Trojans, yeah. Bulldogs. On a neutral field?
Yeah, I think USC beat them. Yeah.
Stanford against Georgia?
Yeah, I think Stanford.
Stanford against South Carolina?
Yeah.
So that's the team. Those are the teams that are going to represent them. That's like, what would SC do to Florida this year?
Yeah, they'd absolutely throttle them.
Destroy them.
Yeah.
Okay, but oh no, SC, this is SCC. You can't talk like that. Well, bullshit. Bullshit, I can't talk like that.
Hell yeah, okay? Man.
Oregon was within a field goal of Auburn, who was the best team, who came back and beat Alabama out of nowhere.
Yeah.
Okay? I mean, so the ideology of having Oregon is we're so far removed from the bullshit. The best teams in each conference are all the same across the country.
Yep.
LSU's better than the rest of the teams, but Bama gave them a hell of a game, and Oregon gave them a good game. Even though Oregon got beat, Oregon gave them a good game. You take away the bullshit turnovers,
yep.
Oregon gave them a good game.
Yeah.
So, I do think that LSU and Bama are better than Oregon, but I don't think that anybody else in the SEC is. Oregon would beat Arkansas by 3 touchdowns.
Yeah, I agree.
They can't hang.
Yep.
Okay.
I agree, man.
Let's do the rest of the Pac-12 here.
Yeah.
The Beavs are terrible.
Yeah.
Okay. They get beat by Cal. Everybody beat Cal this year except for Oregon State, basically.
Yep.
ASU. Does anybody want to win that South Division?
Nah, it seems like UCLA for a second wanted to.
And then what happened to UCLA?
And then they come out and get beat 31-6 by Utah. Who might, I don't think they're going to end up winning it, but shit, man.
They're making a good run
right now. They're making a good case for it, man. Yeah,
so
it's almost like they don't want to win it. Yeah.
It's pathetic.
Yeah, and it sucks because it's, you know, I would like to see that other division be very strong because then
you got to have the Pac-12 represent.
Yeah, exactly, because then that makes winning the Pac-12 an achievement.
Right.
As opposed to now, if you go out and, you beat UCLA for the Pac-12 championship.
Right.
Wow, big shit.
So right now,
cool,
would Georgia
beat UCLA.
ASU? I would say yes.
Yeah, I would think so. Yeah.
I would say Georgia would beat them by maybe 2 touchdowns.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Georgia came out and beat Auburn this
exactly.
week pretty easily.
And so I'm thinking, you know, well, what would happen if these two, you know, the conferences meet up? Yeah. What are the top going to do? What's going to happen to the top here?
Yeah.
I would love to see Stanford, Alabama. I think Alabama would win by maybe a touchdown or two, but I would love to see it.
Yeah, I'd love to see it too, man, because they're actually more evenly...
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
...put together than like a... Because I would love to see Oregon play Oklahoma State.
Yes, it would be phenomenal.
Wouldn't that be just
Well, it was one
awesome
of the best
game.
Games I've ever seen with the Holiday Bowl 2 years ago.
Oh, yeah?
It was phenomenal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd love
and
to see
Dez
that.
And if Bryant doesn't go out in the halftime, Oregon doesn't win by... I think Oregon won by maybe 10 or 12 or 13 or whatever, but that would have been a much closer game.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Love it,
so UCLA gets crushed. Arizona is falling off the wagon.
Yeah, Colorado
48 on them.
Yeah, 48 puts the whooping on them, dude.
Oh, I feel bad for those guys. But Foles will go to the NFL and he'll get paid. And the Beavs.
Yeah, so will Kreiner, the wide receiver.
Uh-huh, exactly. But you might be right when your prediction at the beginning of the year that the Beavs are going to win 2 games, and they are right now.
And they're not going to win anymore, I don't think.
No, because I don't know who they have next week, but the week after that is Oregon.
Oregon, yeah.
I think
they might have Stanford next week.
No, they just played Stanford.
Oh, did they? Oh, yeah, that's
yeah,
right. That's
exactly.
right.
We'll get it, though.
Yeah,
we'll get it.
So I'm going to start talking national. Is that cool?
Let's do this. Yeah, man.
All right, man. So I got to tell you, there's so many things that are nice. I guess I'll just start with
Boise. You want for Christmas. What do you want for Christmas on the BCS list?
Yeah, every exactly, year. Man.
What do you want for Christmas?
So Boise State gets beat by TCU at Boise State. And it was a great
game.
That
was brutal that it was at Boise State.
Yeah, exactly.
That was brutal.
Their last loss was in like 2001 to Washington State.
Oh my Lord.
Yeah, it was Boise State's last home loss.
Unbelievable.
So, but that was awesome. And there was a phantom pass interference on Boise State.
Oh, there was?
It was like, I think it was fourth down and Boise State threw it up. And the guy for Boise State knew he wasn't going to get it, so he flops and gets a penalty thrown on TCU. That's why they were able to then try to kick a field goal for the win.
Football gods.
Yeah, football gods came down. And can't screw with them. Yeah, and he didn't just barely miss bad.
Dude, and I just love the fact that they lost. I just think that is – I was coming home from the Oregon game last year, and we stopped at the pizza restaurant. My boy likes to go stop and play some video games, whatever. Stopped there, and I watched the Nevada loss.
Oh, nice.
And the guy missed both the kicks.
Yeah.
And the crowd was going nuts. And it's all Oregon fans, whatever.
Yeah.
But they're again, perfect example. Don't come in and talk all this shit and then not be able to back it up.
Yeah.
Don't come out here and say that you're one of the best. Say that you can hang with anybody.
We demand respect. Yeah, exactly.
Pound your fist and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah,
and
we have blue turf.
Yeah,
give us respect.
I did think when they made that move to the Mountain West that TCU was going to give them a game.
Yeah.
And here it is. And it was at Boise.
At Boise.
Oh, that's great.
And I got to give some props to the TCU head coach because they could have gone for one and gone for the tie.
When TCU.
And so they go for two. There was some confusion about...
He reminds me of Chip a little bit.
Yeah, he does.
Does he remind you of...
Yeah.
Yeah.
There was a little
Where's the visor and all that?
Yeah, there was a little confusion about the what formation they were going to run for the two-point play.
Right.
So they had to burn a timeout. Quarterback's all pissed off, yelling at people. But they come back out, throw a little hitch to a tight end. The guy for Boise State has his arm. And the guy rips his arm away.
I saw the play.
Because if he had gone down, he wouldn't have made it, man.
No, because the guy actually made...
Oh, yeah.
Pretty much made the tackle.
Yeah, and the...
And he was like, nope. And he ran like almost the other way.
Yeah, and rips his arm free and into the end zone.
That's
so,
karma.
Yeah, I got to give you props for going for two there because that's guts.
What is it, Gary Patterson, right?
Yeah, I think that's right.
Yeah, he's balls, dude. He's big balls like Chip, dude. He went for it. You have to. You're on the road. That's when you play it by the book.
Yeah.
The book says, on the road you go for the win, at home you play
for
the
tie. Yep. So that's awesome.
That is awesome. Just a quick note, who did the Beavs play before us? Washington.
Oh, nice, dude.
Dun, dun, dun.
At Washington.
No, not at Washington.
At
Reser.
Oh, okay.
But Washington is going to go full throttle. After the last couple weeks of getting beat, they're going to go into Reser and just clean house.
Yeah, they're going to crush them. They just got beat by USC bad. So, they're
bad.
Gonna take it out.
Oh, sorry, Beavs.
Yep.
Thanks for coming.
Oh.
Okay, dude, Penn State. Wisconsin. We don't have to go into the Penn State thing right now, but this is the football game alone.
The Penn State-Nebraska one?
Well, no. Penn State is going to have to go against Wisconsin. It's like next week or the week after to see who goes for that side of the conference.
Oh, is that right?
Pac12. Yeah.
Oh, wow,
Because
man.
The whole thing for Oregon is now we're looking at, one, the national championship picture in some sort of foreign world if that happens.
Yeah.
But we're right in line for that Rose Bowl.
Yeah.
So now immediately we look to the Big Ten and say, well, who are we going to get?
Yeah.
And this year it is absolutely up for grabs. Michigan State is winning.
Yep.
So you get Penn State, Wisconsin in like a week or two.
Wow.
That's going to decide it for the other side. Michigan State's going to have it for the other side.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be for the Big 12. Either one of those teams, I think Oregon can beat. I think I am getting very confident about Oregon beating Wisconsin.
Are you?
Very confident. Yeah. Look what we did to Stanford.
Yeah, exactly.
Bring it.
Yeah, and you know, Stanford's not that different than Wisconsin. Wisconsin's got a big team. You know, obviously they have a more mobile quarterback, but not as good of a passer as Luck. So,
no.
Yeah,
I mean,
so,
dude, bring it.
Yeah.
Bring it.
Yeah,
I can smell those roses already, people.
Yeah.
Okay, Oklahoma State. I'm kind of just going BCS. Instead of like, because basically everything else that happens I don't care about.
Yeah.
Oklahoma State has got to play Oklahoma.
Okay, who just beat Texas Tech 66-6. And that's the same
Texas Tech that beat
Oklahoma.
Right.
So.
Which is your whole argument of who beats who. And I totally dig that.
All right.
LSU versus South Carolina, because South Carolina beat Georgia in the first or second week of the season, the first week of the SEC. That's huge.
Yeah.
That game, to me, didn't mean anything when it happened. Yep. Now I look back and I'm like, dude, I want to rewatch that game.
Yeah.
And because that's going to be the decider of who's going to play LSU. Now, LSU probably still wins.
Yeah.
But, dude, come on.
Yeah, there's a lot of interesting things happening. Like, for example, we had let's talk about the championships and stuff like that. We have LSU still has to play Arkansas. And I think LSU is better than Arkansas. I think they'll beat them. But if you look at, in terms of the top 10, Arkansas is one of those teams that's kind of flirting around between Oklahoma, Oregon, Arkansas. Kind of dancing back and forth in terms of rankings.
You know, the BCS things come out tonight, but I think Oregon and all the rest of the polls had jumped everybody.
Yeah.
Except for Bama.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so Arkansas, when LSU beats them, they'll be out of the race. But look at this. If Arkansas beats LSU for some reason, you're going to have Bama with one conference loss. They lost to LSU.
Right.
You're going to have Arkansas with one conference loss. They lost to Bama.
Right.
You're going to have LSU with one conference loss. They lost to
Arkansas.
Arkansas, supposedly. So what happens for the SEC title game?
Round robin. The Pac-12 decides it by BCS rankings.
Right. Yeah, and I have no idea how do they do, like, winning like points for versus points against, like they used to do and stuff like that.
I mean, so, maybe a strength of, see, that's the whole strength of schedule thing.
Yeah,
is that's where you would go to the BCS and say, well, then you would rank the strength of schedule for us, because that's not their each conference's deal.
Yeah, and so, you know, it's really interesting. And
you think Arkansas can beat Bam or beat LSU?
I do not. I do not.
I think LSU wins.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think LSU wins the whole thing. I think LSU.
The national championship.
I think LSU has the best look at the whole thing.
Okay, because here's something that I was talking about before that.
Well, they say defense wins championships, right? Yeah. Can offense win a championship?
Yeah.
See, I mean that's my thing. Last year it didn't, because Auburn had the good D, Oregon had the good O. Auburn wins. Yeah. This year, if it is the Cowboys. Going up against the Tigers, then that's, again, offense versus defense, which I would really like to see Oklahoma State get a shot.
Yeah, me
because
too.
Because Oklahoma State, to me, is almost like the Oregon of Texas southern region, you know, mid-south, whatever you call
it. Yeah, I think they do a lot of things similar, a lot of similar philosophies.
They got the 28-year-old quarterback.
Yeah, we
kind of a wanky type.
Yeah, he actually played some Major League Baseball. Right. And then came back.
Is that what Wanky did too?
Down at Florida State.
Yeah.
Yeah, Chris Wanky. Yeah.
So I think Oklahoma State has a good look at it. I think that they'll probably beat Oklahoma, and they don't have a championship game, so they're in.
Yeah.
So all they have to do is win out.
Yeah, I think Oklahoma State will win out, and I think that what will probably happen is
I want to go to Pasadena. I don't want to go down to the South and go to some national.
Yeah.
That national championship was just such a... It just wore me out.
Come on, man. Give me a break,
Hey,
man.
I wanted to. I love it. Trust me. But seriously, people, we are the Oregon Ducks.
You're getting worn out going to national championships? Come on, man.
Dude.
No, man.
Not going to it. Yeah. But like month and a half of the build-up to it.
Yeah.
Dude, that was an absolute wear.
Hey, man, I'll take the wear and tear.
Well, I will too. Trust me. But dude, seriously, it's like, dude, we're the Oregon Ducks. We are not. That would be our first anything of that.
It's like the ugly girl getting an invite to the prom back to back years.
No, it's like you're not used to the attention. We're a pretty girl, but
happens once, and you're like, I don't know if I trust this happening again.
We're a pretty girl. We just live on the total other side of the world from these people.
Yeah,
everybody who's anything about college football is all about the South and the Midwest.
Yeah.
There is no football in the Northeast.
Yeah.
There is only football in Texas, the Midwest, and the South. Mm-hmm. What is the football out here? There's nothing out here.
Yeah.
For the rest of the world, the rest of our country, they see that as purely, that's it.
Yeah.
So if there's a good Big Ten team, then they get represented. If there's a good Big 12 team, or if there's always a good SEC team.
Yeah.
Other than that, it's like, who gives a shit about the Pac-12?
Yeah.
But Oregon has been good enough the last couple years where it's, I swear to God, I was telling these Washington fans when we're up there, I feel like one day I'm going to wake up from this dream.
Yeah.
This is so... surreal to us. Kelly literally has not lost in the Pac-10 but one game.
Yeah.
He's been the coach for 3 years. What the hell? We're going to go back-to-back-to-back national Pac-12 championships.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous. For us, even going to the national championship is ridiculous.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is that not that I don't want to go to the national championship. I do. Mm-hmm. I would love to win one.
Yeah.
But it's still one of those things where it's like, what does that do for us? As opposed to what is just getting our championship, going to the Rose Bowl, having our day. Because the point that I'm trying to make is that the national championship, to me, seems like it's everybody but the Pac-12, unless you're SC.
Yeah.
Like, Washington got to have their split national championship.
Yeah, I know.
But who else has national championships out here?
Man.
I mean, come on. So it's like the idea is that, man, I just want that freaking Rose Bowl. I want Pasadena. I want to go down. I want to celebrate in the Rose Bowl. Because I would love to see a team like, you know, I don't, there's no way we can do it. They're never going to give us the bid with one loss. Everybody else has one loss. They can't do it.
Yeah.
Bama will go in front of us. Oklahoma will go in front of us if they have one loss.
Yeah.
Oklahoma State could lose to Oklahoma and still go in front of us.
Yeah. Yeah, hell, Arkansas. Even.
Arkansas with one loss.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, if they beat LSU, they could go ahead.
See what I'm saying?
Us.
So,
yeah.
I mean, the way I look at it is not that I don't think that we're worthy. I do. I think that we're probably the second best team in the country.
Yeah, it's
just a different style of football.
Yeah.
But I think from their perspective, from the national perspective, the ESPN or the CBS or the whatever it is, or the Big 12 or the BCS, they look at it as it's the SEC and everybody else.
Yeah.
And the second best team is everybody else this year has been Oklahoma State.
So who's
they are
who's
running
who's
away
playing with
in
it. The national title?
Oklahoma State and LSU.
Yeah. I think so too. I think they'll both win out. Like you said, Big 12 doesn't have a championship game. LSU will beat the hell out of South Carolina in the SEC championship.
And then I think that Oregon goes and plays anybody in the Big 10. I think Oregon wins.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
And I can see Oregon being rated the number two team at the end of the year.
Now, you know what's interesting?
Because you know how they do that? At the end of the year, they'll have their last rankings at the end of the year.
Yeah.
And it's the national championship loser will not always be the second place team.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Yeah.
So Oregon could win, and Oregon could be the number two team at the end of the year.
Right? That's right. Now, Just to make things interesting.
Sorry for wasting all these people's time.
No, this is good stuff. Okay. This is why they tune in, man.
Thank you.
Okay, so let's say we have an Arkansas upset at LSU at the end of the year, and we have Oklahoma beat Oklahoma State for their last game of the year. You're going to then have
everybody with one loss.
LSU, Oklahoma State, Oklahoma, Bama, LSU, Arkansas, Stanford, and then Clemson or Va Tech. All with just one loss.
If they all have one loss,
yeah,
Oregon actually might get the nod.
Yeah, they?
Because their loss came first.
That's what I've been trying to say all the time, man, is that since they lost first, the first game of the year, they'll work their way up the ladder and so
maybe not over Bama. Because
well, as long as they're in the
LSU so close.
As long as they're in the top two, they don't have to be the first.
But you see what I'm saying, though?
That
if everybody had one loss,
yeah,
they might go Bama, LSU.
Yeah, now
again.
Now check
rather
this,
than Oregon.
Check this out. What if after Arkansas, if Arkansas beats LSU and LSU wouldn't even play for the SEC championship, they do
that
so.
Would be huge.
Yeah.
Now, could that remember that year that Nebraska did that?
Yeah.
They didn't play in the Big 12 championship and
they got the nod. Yeah.
Over Oregon.
Yeah, and got beat.
Yes. I don't know.
Yeah,
I think
isn't this fun though?
It is. It
doesn't
is.
This just make you?
I would love to see Oregon.
Hell, they could put
have another chance at the national championship.
You know, if it worked like that, and Arkansas beat LSU, and LSU didn't even play for the SEC championship, they could put like Oregon against Bama for the national title. You know, I mean
that
could,
would be pretty awesome.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm not trying to say that I wouldn't want Oregon to be the national championship. I'm just trying to say that it's so
I know, you're
foreign. It's so surreal.
You don't want to be greedy.
It's
you don't
also,
wanna,
to me, it really pisses me off that everybody
granted.
Just wants to focus on the national championship game and nothing else matters.
Yeah.
like no other bowls matter. There's 30 fucking bowls.
Yeah, like it's either national championship or bust.
Yeah, yeah. It's like there's one winner at the end of the year. Yeah. Like, bullshit, the silver medal is awesome.
Yeah, man, you can melt that shit down, make some bullets, the kill silver some werewolves. Fuck yeah, man.
The silver medal is still the second best of everybody else.
Yeah.
I mean, hell yeah. So anyway, yeah, for sure. Let's talk about the NFL, shall we?
Yeah, first of all,
anything else, BCS?
Well, I just want to say I dig your top 10 list. That was awesome. That's a good idea. I think that should be a feature on the show. And you guys write in, tell me if you agree with me.
There's my notes.
We ought to have a top 10 list, kind of like the Dave Letterman top 10 list, except this will be funny and informative.
Everybody's got a top 10 list.
Yeah, man. So I think that's a segment we ought to introduce into the show, man.
How about a top 9?
Top 9? Yeah, let's do something a little
lazier. I don't want to get exactly 10.
And based on the topic, maybe it'll just be 3 or 4.
Sure, you know? Sure. We could whittle down. Downsize.
It's our list. So yeah,
we can outsource it.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's a good idea, man.
Okay, let's do NFL real quick. NFL, two things that shocked me. Are you ready?
Yeah,
NFL?
Let's do it, man.
Okay, two things that shocked me. Is the NFL really good or is the NFL really bad?
It's bad.
Because the teams that we think are good the next week turn out to be bad.
Yeah, I mean, not just like, ooh, they narrowly escape, but no, they get killed by the Bears.
Okay, so like Detroit we thought was good 3 weeks ago. Yeah. Now they've lost like 3 in a row or something. The Bills. Now, so is everything just about parity? And is like, so because at the end of the year, what I feel is that games or teams are going to the playoff based on like what happens in one game that happened 2 months ago. That means everybody's exactly the same. And there's only maybe one or two teams that's better. Am I right with that?
Yeah, I think you're right about that.
So this year it's Green Bay.
Green Bay.
And then the second class is kind of muddled.
Yeah.
There's a couple different teams there.
Yeah, because, you know, for a bit, like you were saying, like Detroit and Buffalo were being
included. Baltimore, hello?
Yeah, Baltimore.
Seattle?
Yeah, getting beat by Seattle, man.
22-17, Baltimore lost to the Sea Chickens.
Is that right? The game's over now?
And they,
oh, yeah, it's a final.
And it was out here.
Yeah.
Which might be tough going across country, but, dude, Seattle was terrible. They were the worst offense in the entire league.
Yeah.
And they scored 22 points against one of the best defenses in the entire... Like, explain this to
the
NFL.
Ravens, the
How
Ravens,
does this work?
Yeah, the Ravens were slated to be one of the Super Bowl teams, perhaps.
Yeah.
And then you have like a team like Philadelphia, who's getting... Yeah, who'd they get beat today by? Arizona.
Oh, my God.
Like, Kevin
Kolb.
That. Yeah, yeah, my man...
Kolb.
My man Kolb. Kolb.
I think Indy gets luck. Because Miami won. Indy still is not winning.
Yeah.
Indy is still got beat by Jacksonville 17-3.
Yeah.
And Jacksonville was terrible.
Yeah.
St. Louis by 1 over Cleveland.
Cleveland.
Dude, St. Louis has won 2 or 3 games now this year.
Yeah. I mean, Steven Jackson's a money back. They got
What if Steven Jackson was on a good team?
Oh, yeah.
Dude, he'd be like a Hall of Famer.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it's kind of like what you saw with Adrian Peterson where, you know, for a couple years there, man, that guy was just money because he was on a pretty good team. And now he's having a rough go because this team's terrible, man.
The best game of the day that I saw was New Orleans and Atlanta. That was a hell of a game to watch.
Yeah.
Yeah, went into overtime. It was awesome. Got to see Quiz make a nice little play.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm all right with supporting a B when they're in the pros.
Yeah, that's
They're
cool.
not hurting us anymore.
Yeah, and then you have the...
Dallas just blows Buffalo.
Yeah, which I don't get because I thought Buffalo was supposed to be half decent. And then you have the teams that aren't kind of mid-level teams, but now are moving up, like the Niners. They beat the Giants today.
Dude.
And Giants beat New England last week.
Wow.
So how good is San Francisco, really? Or
Dude,
how
San
good
Francisco's
is,
good.
Or how good is people, how good are the Giants, really? You know, was that...
The Giants are not as good as probably people think they are.
Was the Giants win over the Patriots a fluke, or was the Niner win over the Giants a fluke?
The Giants over the Patriots is more of a
was
fluke.
A fluke, okay.
Yeah, the Niners are legit. Like,
are
the Niners
really?
Are legit, yes. They're going to get a bye.
So I know they got Alex Smith. I know they got Frank Gore. I know they got Vernon Davis.
Here's the thing with the Niners.
I know
they sucked the last 2 years.
Yeah, and
they
bring
in
Harbaugh.
They bring in Harbaugh.
Last couple years, but I didn't think they were this year.
They bring in Harbaugh. They have no OTAs. They have no offseason. They have barely a workout at the beginning of the year. And they're kicking everybody's ass with the same crew they had before.
Yeah.
What the hell is that?
That Singletary had. Yeah.
What the hell is that?
Yeah, it makes you
it
wonder.
It makes Mike Singletary on my Super Bowl shuffle over here look like a clown. Well, he kind of looks like a clown on that, too.
Yeah, Singletary is a coaching tactic. Didn't he, like, rip his pants down? And
yeah, he said that these guys were ass. Yeah, he mooned his own team to
Yeah,
well, you have to give the visual. Nobody knows what you're talking about when you say you guys are playing like ass.
Yeah, you're gonna. And then you probably did this one.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
To emphasize it. Oh, my God. Yeah, talk about a difference, man.
Well, you know, Jesus Christ. I have no idea when it comes to the NFL.
It should be.
If I was a betting man, which I'm not, but if I were a betting man, I would know never to touch the NFL.
Yeah,
I mean, it would break my bank every week.
That's a good instinct right there.
I mean, see, Miami won today. They beat Washington.
Yeah, and what Washington had an okay start to the season,
right,
too.
Right,
with Rex Grossman as the quarterback. So you basically got Green Bay, who's money. And then you've got the Patriots, the Steelers, the Ravens that are kind of next tier. And then you have the Niners. You have the I don't know who else is in there. Niners, Giants, I guess. New Orleans, Atlanta. Detroit's now kind of in there. Buffalo's in there.
Those guys are sliding because they haven't been that good lately.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh's probably in there.
Yeah.
Even though they look old.
Yeah. So it's, I don't know, man. I think you're. Your idea not to bet the games is a good one.
Now, how about
Oakland over San Diego?
Yeah.
San Diego was supposed to be good.
I know. It was like 3 or 4. That was the Thursday night game.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, that's right. I remember that now.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's just crazy out there. And then tonight, we're doing this. It's like 4:45 on the Sunday. We're doing this. We haven't seen the New England Jets game and then obviously the Green Bay game. But we know who's going to win that one.
Yeah.
So NFL is what it is. Yeah, exactly. NFL is what it is. We don't need to worry too much about that. We go to our next topic. We good here?
Yeah, man, we're good.
Anything
I can't.
NFL?
You know, I think we're good, man. I can't wait until some more college football comes around. It's literally, you know, the best time of the year.
Yeah, it's my favorite sport.
Yeah, it's my favorite sport too, by far. Like college basketball is awesome too.
Yeah. Let's go college basketball really quickly, dude. The Ducks started. We went to Vanderbilt and had a really terrible game. Tons of turnovers. Couldn't hit free throws.
Vanderbilt's actually not.
Vanderbilt's a good
team.
Pretty
good, yeah.
They're good. They're top 10.
Yeah.
But went to Vandy, and they have the benches behind the basket.
Really? I haven't
seen
that.
Not on the side.
Wow, that's
kind of weird.
Yeah. Must be a southern thing. They're in Tennessee.
Exactly. There. But we're starting to look okay. The Ducks recruiting is getting better. The Ducks are starting to look okay. Yeah.
Good.
Got the big center now from Wake Forest. And we brought in the shooter, the couple kids who can stroke it a little bit.
I'm going to have to look them up, man. I don't know a whole lot about the new crew.
Yeah. And I'll do the video. I got the video of. We're going to see a couple games this year. I'm going to go see Virginia. Ooh. So I can see that's Tony Bennett's team, the kid who was the coach of Wazoo a couple years ago when Wazoo was good going to the tournament. Now he's at Virginia. I'll see the Virginia game, and I'll, of course, see the Beav game. You got to represent those Civil Wars whenever you can. I like to see them Civil Wars. So I'll give you the video of those games.
They got cheerleaders at those?
Yes.
Okay,
and the cheerleaders do their thing at the football or in basketball games, I should say.
Right on.
But that's that. And then, just so exciting. I love Duck basketball. I'm a huge fan of Duck basketball. Always as a kid was just really, that's my favorite place in all campus is Matt Court. And now we have the new arena. It's like a little mini Rose Garden. It is awesome. It is awesome. Okay. Last topic.
Yeah.
What should you do and not do in a riot? Okay. Let's do the Penn State riot first.
Okay.
If you are one of the students, what are the biggest do's and don'ts here?
This is at a Penn State riot?
Well, let's just do the Penn State riot.
Okay, yeah.
Because we saw that happen.
Yeah. If
you're a Penn State student, you're super pissed they just fired Joe Pa.
Which I am in reality.
And you're really drunk.
And I'm really drunk, which I am in reality.
Okay.
Let's see. What do I do? I want to...
Do you tip a news van?
Yeah, news van, definitely. I wouldn't do it to a cop car, but the news, the media, they're part of the reason why Joe Pa's gone.
Easier to tip over.
Yeah, more top heavy, taller.
Yeah, and they are responsible. My biggest problem with this whole Penn State... Sorry to cut you off.
No, we're good, man. We're a team.
This whole Penn State thing is that the media was the one that was the most upset about this.
Yeah. Exactly.
The media, where were you in 98? Where were you in 2002? Where were you? Everybody was like, oh, but they were coming. Well, where was the media?
Yeah,
The media is upset about the fact that they just learned about the grand jury testimony. That was last... They were doing this last year.
Yeah.
This story had been happening. This story was happening 10 years ago.
Yeah.
This guy Sandusky should have been busted years ago by the media.
Yeah, by the media. Or how about the athletic... The AD or the president of the university.
So if the media was so powerful in 2011 to take down mighty Penn State, I personally think Penn State needed the out. How are you going to fire Joe Pa?
Exactly. That's exactly what
they were looking
happened.
For any reason possible to fire this guy.
And it would be pretty difficult since he's leading the Big Ten right now.
And his contract's up at the end of the year.
Oh, is that right?
Yes. This is the last year of his contract. You going to re-sign him?
They don't want to, but they would have to because
he'd be going into a Big Ten championship game.
Yeah, exactly. He'd be going to the Rose Bowl maybe or something.
Maybe the Rose Bowl.
Yeah, exactly. How do you fire? Yeah. And you know, the crazy thing too is he said, you know what, I'll resign at the end of the year.
I know.
So he even gave them an out by saying, you know.
But I think they were a little pissed that he kind of, the head football coach for 48, I mean. Anytime you have these leaders of these things for more than about 40 years, they get a little crazy. You know, Gaddafi was in power for 42 years. Look what he was doing.
Hey, man, I think he had a great fashion sense.
Now, I'm not comparing Gaddafi to Paterno, but you start to have these people start to, like, worship these football coaches. They're just a football coach.
Yeah.
And not that great of a football coach in the last couple of years, if you really look at it, right?
Yeah.
What's he doing? Yeah. What's Joe Pa bringing the tip. I know what Chip Kelly's doing in practice.
Yeah.
I know what he's doing on the recruiting trail. I know what he's doing breaking down film. Yeah. How much is Joe Pa breaking down the film?
Yeah.
How much is he standing in front of the guys?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and I think part of it is they wanted to bring in young blood, new offense, that kind of stuff. And it's difficult to do that with Joe Pa at the helm.
Joe Pa's like a statue who's still alive.
But you know what's going to happen is it's going to happen just like it did at Michigan, where they bring in Rodriguez from West Virginia.
It'll get ugly.
They bring in this new spread offense. They suck ass because it's terrible for their
break
system.
It down.
They'll bring in
the
some
guy
named Jimbo, you know, 4 years
Brady
later.
Hoke.
Yeah, Hoke. What a great name.
He doesn't even wear the headphones.
Is that right?
Good for him,
man.
He does not wear headphones on the sideline.
That's awesome. Yeah. And he'll reinstitute.
He just sits there and watches the game.
Yeah, and so he'll reinstitute the old offense, and they'll get back to regular football.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, I think it's a shame. I think the guy, Joe Pa, told his superiors, he's not a police officer. It's not his job to investigate these things. His superiors are responsible.
And those are the guys who lied to the grand jury.
Yeah.
Those are the guys who tried to cover up for Sandusky.
Yeah.
Paterno never did.
Yeah.
Paterno had one interaction. The McQuarrie guy comes to him, tells him, he tells the other guys. Yeah. Now, should have Paterno called the cops? Well, I guess mandatory reporter, you are in the state system, you probably should have been notifying somebody of a higher authority.
Yeah.
DHS or somebody. I mean, somebody's got to be getting notified here.
Yeah.
But, bro, he notified his boss. He notified people who are higher up than him on the chain, chain of command.
Yeah, chain of command. Now, here's a little query for you fans out there. Let's say, when the Sandusky thing goes to trial, what happens if he's found not guilty? Did you just fire Joe Paterno, an athletic director and a president of a major university, over something that didn't happen? You know what I'm saying?
Well,
like, innocent until proven guilty?
I know.
Do we do that anymore in this country?
I know, but grand jury testimony is very valued in our country.
Oh, yeah. That's how they determine if they proceed to trial or not.
So it's kind of one of those cases where it seems as if it's pretty much laying it out. Now, not to say that the system can't find him guilty.
Yeah.
I mean, OJ was found guilty.
Yeah, well, he was found not guilty.
I mean, he was found not guilty.
Yeah, and see, that's the big thing, too, here is obviously
you fire Joe Pa when he's not guilty?
Yeah,
wow.
Now, obviously, if this guy is guilty, he doesn't deserve life in prison. He deserves the death penalty.
Oh, yeah.
So let's not get that backwards. No. I don't think they should even bother taking him out of the courtroom. They ought to just hang him in the courtroom. You know, just have some guy, like, kind of like shining up a 12-gauge shotgun in the corner. And as they open the verdict from the jury, don't even say anything. Just either nod or shake your head. And the guy's, like polishing the 12-gauge. He'll nod back and just do the job.
Wow.
You know, just finish it like that. You know, take him behind a curtain in the corner of the room.
Splatter.
Yeah, so nobody can see it. And then there's a loud bang, and then the guy comes back out and starts polishing the shotgun again. All right, so let's get that straight. If this guy is guilty, he deserves a death. So.
Oh, yeah. I mean, dude, this is brutal. I mean, this is absolutely brutal. Yeah. And I'm really glad that Sports Chat 503 is not like an everyday talk show.
Yeah.
Because for the last week, I've heard these talk show hosts just grinding this story into the
ground. Oh, yeah. It's the lead story on everything.
Oh, and over and over. I mean, how many times do I need to hear sodomy or this? Or I mean, geez, that's not really my style.
Yeah.
Really, what I want to focus on is, what does it do to Penn State? How does it do to Penn State? And then I immediately started thinking, what were the do's and don'ts of how you're going to riot?
Yeah, and, you know, let's get back to that. Yeah.
Because when these kids are rioting, how do I do this the right way? How do I riot at Penn State the right way?
One thing that I know, I want to...
Candlelight vigil on Joe Pa's lawn?
Yeah, no, you know...
Like, his house is a nativity scene from Christmas, where you're, like, lighting the candles, and you're, like, praying, and... I mean, I like the chanting, "We are Penn State." I think that's their deal. That's kind of like our Go Ducks, you know? Yeah. That's fine. But, you know, it's a tough one. Because when you're really chanting for Joe Pa, it's kind of an insincere moment when all this stuff is talking about these kids getting raped in the showers.
Yeah, and because honestly, you know, it's created a bit of a split where now you're either for Penn State or you're for Joe Pa.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's a split. Now, in terms of rioting, I know after you're good and liquored up and you've tipped over the news van, because we both agree that's
the news van's got to go.
Yeah.
It got to go.
Next, I want to look. There's two
Not
things.
From my perspective as a 33-year-old house owner, homeowner with a family.
Father and exactly.
That father. But as a 21-year-old or 20-year-old, I probably wouldn't even do it if I was 21. I would be a freshman or sophomore.
Right, good, yeah.
Okay, so 18, 19, or 20.
Yeah.
Nobody's 21 yet.
Yeah. First thing that I'm thinking is, I don't like wearing clothes anymore. I'm getting naked.
Naked?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's part of rioting, too.
Of course
because
it is.
Have you ever tried to grab onto
It's extreme rioting.
Yeah, and when you're nice and sweaty and naked, the cops try to grab you, they can't grab you. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. So, that's important.
Now, do you think does mace affect the body? Like, eyes?
You
does
know,
it
that's
burn the body?
Like, if they spray it on your arms,
on your
genitals,
would that be by burning?
You know, I know it doesn't burn
your
genitals.
Spray it
all
over your body?
I don't think
liquid
it
icy hot.
Yeah, right. I think it just, when you breathe in the vapors.
Yeah, it's more affects the...
And then when it touches eyes or nose or throat.
So, news van's gotta go.
Newsman's got to go close, but I do like the rioting look where you take like a bandana or a towel and wrap it around your head so like your face can't be seen.
It looks more intimidating.
Yeah, it does. You.
It looks like you're prepared.
Yeah. It looks like you have some forethought. Yeah. What
it's
about
like the
you?
Uniform of rioting.
If you're the student, what are
you
thinking about?
Breaking bottles. I'm into breaking bottles because there's no real rule against it.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So
I mean,
I'm so mad.
And it's your bottle.
Right, I mean, maybe the endangering the paws of dogs.
Yeah.
Because they're not even really endangers tires anymore. Do tires get broken by broken glass anymore?
Not really,
no. So I'm into that. I'm into some throwing of bottles and breaking stuff. Now, how about Molotov cocktail? How about lighting something on fire and trying to blow something up?
You know,
can you go that route, or is that a no-no? Anything explosive or... Can you go fire...
You know, with the state of drunkenness that you are, I would suggest no. Just
How
because
about,
the one time
fireworks.
The like, fireworks are
a,
cool.
Like a sparkler and writing Joe Pa's name.
Yeah, that's kind of Roman candle and act like it's shooting out of your dick and but you know, with the
How about
the,
shooting a Roman candle at the cops?
I don't know. It depends on what the campus security is like. You might get shot.
Okay, here's a good question. If it's campus security, do you act more crazy than if it's the cops?
Yeah, because you don't like campus security.
Like, do you rush them?
Because they're rent-a-cops, man.
Do
you're not a
them?
Real cop.
If you're in a group?
Yeah. Well, if you're in a group and, you know, you're can't be identified, sure. Yeah, you're a kid. You're hammered. Go for it, man.
Riot.
Yeah, riot it up, man. Go have a good time. Try to... Because I don't even think those guys carry guns, so there's no threat of, like... You know, he was going to take my gun, so I had to shoot him. No, I don't think they do that.
You know what I think would be a good thing for riots is going to the produce stand and getting some melons. You know, some, like,
doing
watermelon.
Some Gallagher improv.
Gallagher. A lot of Gallagher going on. Spray them with melon. Or eggs.
Eggs is, yeah, I eggs mean, is
I'm
cool.
I'm just trying to supply myself with things that I really don't, there's not like a city ordinance against me using.
That's good.
Breaking bottles, breaking eggs, watermelons.
Yeah, they can't be
throwing
considered.
Potatoes. Potatoes could be a pretty good weapon, though.
Yeah, that's good. I like that because it's nice and dense and it's, yeah.
It's you not can, a rock.
Yeah, exactly. It's a vegetable.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a root.
Throwing celery. Breaking it off.
You have the stalks used like fletchings on the back, like an arrow.
That'd be pretty sweet.
Yeah.
I just, you know, you got to get creative if you're a 21-year-old. I mean, I'd personally be probably so inebriated, I wouldn't be actually out there. I'd be like, yeah, bam.
You're the guy that falls down the stairs running outside to go
Let's
protest.
Go! Okay, let's talk about what are you going to do if you want to be a peaceful protester?
Yeah.
Do you make a sign?
Yeah, signs are good. Candles. I like signs. Candles are good because it's, you know, there's a little play there because you have the menacing fire, mm-hmm. but it's presented in a peaceful way.
It protects you. Like, nobody can get close to me because
yeah, exactly.
have fire in my hands.
Yeah, there's a, like a...
How about candle, but also have a bottle of 151 and just go like flamethrower at any one moment?
That's a great idea. Candle and a bottle of hairspray. Yeah. And you're just kind of.
Don't get close, man. Just light it up a couple times.
I like that idea, man. I like the guys that that just stand there and go like this to the cops.
Yeah.
If I was a cop, I would want to break those fingers so goddamn bad.
How about just split it with like an axe right through the middle of the thing? Take like a machete.
Yeah! That's good. But I don't know. What about the...
peaceful rioters. Rioters who want to really give their word out that it was untrue.
I shouldn't
have been firing Joe Pa. He's a legend. He's a demigod.
Yeah, I say chain yourself to stuff.
I think that's very productive.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. The cool thing is when they get
If you're Penn State, would you chain into the house? A fence? A tree?
Maybe chain yourself to like, what would you chain yourself to?
The news van?
The news van that's on its side on fire. You're like, guys, we chained ourselves to the axle.
Give me the key.
But what they do is they take like pipe, right?
Okay.
And put a zip tie around your hand. Okay. You stick your arm in the pipe. I stick my arm in the other side of the pipe, zip tie it. Then we're tied together inside the pipe so you can't just come by and cut it and separate
it. How do you untie?
That's a great point.
Now they're like, sweet, nobody's going to untie us.
Yeah, that's,
how do we do it now?
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. Yeah, wouldn't that be great? They're like,
shop class?
Yeah, they just... Yeah, how do you do it without accidentally maybe cutting somebody's hand off? That's a great point, man. But yeah, I like that idea.
The occupiers aren't thinking about that yet, though. No. The rioters, they aren't thinking about that. They're like thinking, how do we do this human chain?
Yeah, exactly.
Without killing ourselves, basically.
Yeah, yeah. Well, see, with rioters, the second the pepper spray comes out, you separate the men from the pussies.
Yeah.
The people just start running.
Okay, let's talk about the Occupy movement here, okay? First of all, Occupy, the biggest point I have there is that the people in our part neck of the woods, on the third day of the Occupy movement, the Occupy people were gone and they're replaced by homeless.
Yeah, homeless and mentally ill.
Yeah, by the third day. These hipster kids who want to get out there who don't have a job because they don't care and they're not educated, those people were gone. Yeah. They were out of that movement. They're like, this is kind of cold down here. I'm going to go get a Starbucks with my freaking dad's money.
Yeah.
The people who moved into that campsite were homeless. Was the dude who's a Vietnam War vet. The other dude who's like,
The other guy thinks he's a Vietnam War vet.
Yeah, he's like, I got flashbacks, man.
Yeah.
But dude, that place was absolutely out of control. They had it downtown by the front of the courthouse or whatever.
Yeah,
and then they moved it to up in the Pearl District to really show them.
Yeah, we're
going to really occupy this thing. Well, like last night, Portland is just classic, people. If you don't know Portland is so liberal that they will not even let the mayor of the town have a political connection.
Yeah.
The mayor cannot be a Republican or a Democrat. The mayor is just the mayor. They have no political affiliation.
Yeah, there's no title that they
It's
can...
just the mayor.
Yeah.
And our mayor right now is gay. So his only real political affiliation is he's the gay mayor.
Yeah.
Like, that's the only thing you can say that he...
Yeah, that's the only addition team, to the title you can give.
Exactly. So our city is just wild. We will allow craziness to happen. We will totally... And then we'll just totally overreact to it and just start beating the hell out of people. So they let these occupiers stay for, you know, what was it? A month? Two months?
Yeah, it's been like 5 weeks now, yeah.
Okay. So they let them stay for about a month and maybe a couple, 5 weeks, 6 weeks. You're on the fifth week, okay? And all of a sudden, the mayor's like, we're done.
Yep.
12 o'clock, midnight, you got to be out. This was like last night, okay? So you have all these burnouts who are sitting in there, you know. They're like, what? There's a, and I'm expecting like cops in full riot gear marching down the street at midnight, just cleaning house. My joke was, I told my wife, just be hitting the edges of the tents. Just hitting the tents as hard as you could, man. You don't even care who's in them.
Like the Jewish ghettos in Germany where they're just totally, dragging people around.
Because seriously, the Portland police, we did have a pretty good run of killing people in the last year.
Yeah.
Portland police are responsible for quite a few deaths out there.
Yeah, there's a number of lawsuits pending.
Yes, so the tension is a little bit tight in the city. All these protesters are totally wondering, oh, what's going to happen to us when the cops come to collect? And I was really wanting to see that. And you said you saw some of the live footage today. What did you see on that, buddy?
Yeah, it was. They'd gotten...
anybody bloodied?
No, they'd gotten everybody out of the park, but now they're just all standing in the middle of the street. And
I saw one picture in the newspaper where a person had a full-on dresser of drawers.
Oh, I saw a dresser
too.
Did you
see that in the paper?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, what the hell? They're actually taking down a
dresser.
That's
what I was thinking. Is like, who brought that in? Like, hey, you know
they're
where
really
this
occupying.
Yeah, exactly. I need to sort my clothes. What? Oh,
okay,
just...
folding the clothes, putting them in here. Okay.
Hey, you dummy, that's a sock drawer. Yeah, so...
Guy comes to rob it, comes in the sock drawer.
So, yeah, they were just picking up, like, the city had workers in there picking up and dismantling.
Oh, talk about
tents,
the trash.
And, yeah, man, just tons. They had backhoes in there picking it up. They had dump trucks coming in, and now they've erected cyclone fences around them.
Good.
And so you can't get into the park
it's
anymore.
Like, it's like ground zero.
Yeah, it is, a little bit, yeah, man.
There's like a now like a tribute going up on the fence.
Oh, sure, yeah, that would make sense. Yeah, kind of like the Kyron
Horman. Keep
that
Kyron Horman's fence,
yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Just combo them. Kyron Horman somehow, somewhere Kyron stops and the Occupy starts. They're like, what is this anti-corporation stuff about Kyron? I thought this kid was an 8-year-old killed by somebody. God damn.
Wow, that's funny.
Yeah, dude, that is pretty classic.
So, yeah, they're just in the streets telling
them. It'll
be
at some Albertsons parking lot.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the thing, dude, is that they're telling them, you know, now we're going to open up the streets to traffic.
They should go to Walmart.
Yeah, 5 minutes to vacate.
They should go to Walmart. You can stay in the Walmart parking lot.
Oh, can you? Yeah, I've heard
about
stuff
like that.
Dude,
they should be fighting Walmart. That should be their Occupy Walmart.
Yeah, they're a big corporation.
Walmart, how could Walmart kick them out?
Yeah.
They allow the homeless people to live in their freaking parking lot.
Really? I did.
Dude, yes.
I know that some places you can, like, if you have an RV, that you're allowed to park overnight. But,
yeah, dude, Mikey worked out at the Walmart for, like, 6 months.
Really?
Putting in the whole new registers and everything. Basically, Walmart has added a whole grocery department.
Is that right?
Yes. So Mikey was out there working at it. He saw the same dude in a truck the entire time. 6 months. And he had his dogs in the back with him. He slept in the back of a truck. He'd get out in the morning with his robe on and fire up his barbecue.
Wow,
in the
dude.
Parking lot.
Holy cow.
For 6 months.
That is nuts, man.
Every day.
I feel bad for those dogs.
Yeah, exactly.
But okay. Yeah, man. So, I don't know. It's I imagine they'll keep it going somewhere else.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, so that's it for us. I just thought it was kind of interesting. What are the do's and don'ts of rioting? My biggest question is, do you tip over the medium news van? Is that really...
Because honestly,
the enemy.
They're doing this for attention, are they not?
Right.
And then the people that are giving them the exposure...
Media.
Are the, yeah.
It's a... Right.
Yeah, they don't even get
symbiotic relationship.
Yeah, right.
Right. All right, everybody. So, boom. Next week, SC... Huge game.
Check for the video of the game online.
Yep. We'll have it up. I'll try to have it up by maybe Sunday night of next week, maybe Monday. Boom. This is my universal sign for filming. I'll be filming at that game. I'll try to give you as much of it as possible. If I can film the USC song girls, I will, people, because I know there's some serious cheerleader addiction.
Are those the ones in the long white sleeve sweaters?
Yes.
Oh, I like that.
Yes. Yeah, they have historically always rated as the highest on the sexy level of outfits.
Nice.
I think probably Playboy runs that. But Duck cheerleaders are up there, too. They say the Duck cheerleaders are one of the hottest in the country.
Yeah, I like them, too.
Boom. So I'll try to give you as much footage as possible. I always like to try to give you a couple footage of maybe the before what's happening in the game, the kind of the walk up, the tailgate, the walk up to the stadium, and then a little bit of what's happening in the game. Try to give you some stuff first quarter. By the end of like maybe the second quarter, almost halftime, my camera is like already running out of battery power. Yeah. So I'm trying to kind of conserve energy for the last little bit. So I usually have more first half footage than second half footage. Maybe I'll try to get more second half this next time. But it's going to be a hell of a night. It's going to be 5 o'clock on Saturday. I still think Oregon's going to win. And then the next week, I'll be at the Beav game, and I'll do that same thing for the Beav game. It'll be a hell of a run.
Yep.
And then if we do get it, I will be at the Pac-12 championship game as well.
Nice,
so if that happens, which it's pretty much going to happen at this point,
yep.
I'll have that video as well. So we still have 3 more home games at Oregon.
Yeah, that's
that amazing. Is awesome. And then we've got the bowl game, and anything happens.
Yeah.
This one goes out. Special shout out to my dad. Had foot surgery this week. You got to keep fighting, my man. You got to keep fighting, but it is a good fight.
Stay up there, Bean.
So give your positive thoughts and prayers and everything else out to my dad if you could on that one. He is struggling at the hospital, and this is classic. My dad is the classic worst-case scenario man.
Yep.
He's at the hospital. I'm there at 3 o'clock. The game starts at 5. I call him up at right when we had the first play. He doesn't have the freaking K2. He doesn't have channel 2 on his TV.
He doesn't get channel 2?
It's like the most big ABC.
Yeah.
He's flipping. He's like, what? I can't.
Wow.
I call him. He says, yeah, I'm having a technician come up here to try to set it up. He missed the whole first half.
Oh, no.
Dude, didn't even see. He's in the hospital. He had surgery the night before.
Oh, buddy.
Full-on foot surgery. Reconstructive. The whole freaking thing.
Wow. You're kidding me.
So he's getting kind of screwed there. So give some shouts out to my dad. Give some good energy out there to him, and hopefully he can get through this bad boy. You got to keep fighting, baby.
Yeah.
Keep fighting. Okay, Sports Chat 503, thanks for watching. Oregon Live, Addicted to Quack, however else you're finding this thing. If you're finding it on somebody's cell phone, cool with that. Keep watching. We're here every week. Try to give you the roundabout of what's going on in sports and in our world. Cool with that?
Yeah, good, man.
All right.
I like it.
Sports Chat 503, see you next week.
Be good.
Peace.